You.
Today on Animal Outtakes.
I tell everybody these guys are my overgrown chihuahuas.
So they're big puppies, right?
Big puppies.
From riding camelback to hand-feeding water buffalo. We're going on a safari. Join us as we learn about antelope, zebra, and even greet a llama or two along the way.
Don't you wonder what they're thinking of us?
Yeah, quite often.
Welcome to Animal Outtakes. Today, we're going on a safari.
We'll meet some interesting animals like water buffalo and kudu while exploring on camelback.
It's going to be a great adventure, so let's get going.
There's nothing quite like an African safari, getting to see the animals up close and in their natural habitats. But for many of us, a trip to this vast continent may be impossible. So there are ways to take the journey without leaving the country.
We are a 260-acre working game ranch. We do things like baling our own hay. We have free-range chickens. We raise and sell their eggs. But what most people are interested in are these large herds of exotic hoofstock we have out here. We have stuff from Africa, Asia, South America. We just come out here and take a look around and see what we see on any given day.
We're here in West Central Florida on a nice breezy day with our friend Ron, and we're going to go on a camel ride. You ready to go?
I'm not so sure about this. Let's try it.
Let's go.
One of the first animals we came across on the ranch is the camel.
Well, it's pretty high up. Now, I can see where you sit with two humps, but I'm not quite sure with one hump. Oh, back there.
There are two types of camel, Bactrian and dromedary.
The easiest way to remember the difference, if you take a capital B and turn on its side, it has two humps, Bactrian. If you take a capital D and turn on its side, it has one hump, dromedary. Bactrians are from Asia, and dromedaries are from Africa.
While found on different continents, there is a similarity between the two subspecies. You'll find them living in the desert or prairies. Camels and people have a long history together. Camels were domesticated over 3,000 years ago. Their hair is used in making fabrics like leather and wool, and they're excellent for getting around town.
Well, let me tell you, you get a whole different perspective up here. And they give you a pretty smooth ride.
Sometimes called the ships of the desert, camels can carry up to about 500 pounds on their backs.
What's amazing to me are the legs. And even though that the legs are sturdy, I mean, look at what they're carrying on top.
Yep. How do they manage to do that? It's the same way as with a horse. All their bones and their ligaments and everything are all just set up to carry that weight, to balance them out.
The camel's hump is probably the most distinguishing feature of these animals. Many people think that the hump is filled with water, but that's just a myth.
The humps are actually full of fat, not water. A lot of people think they're full of water. They're full of fat, and that's actually better for the camel. They can use that fat deposit as a food source or water source, whatever they happen to need.
Camels belong to a group called ungulates, or hooved animals. Horses, pigs, and deer are all ungulates. But when it comes to camels, their feet are a little bit different.
They aren't hooves. They have two toes, and they actually have a soft pad underneath. And if you think about it, that's actually better in the desert on the sand, because when they're moving around, that will spread out and give them a larger area on top of that sand.
Desert life can be tough, but the camels are built for it. They can withstand extreme temperature changes from 40 degrees below zero to 100 degrees Fahrenheit.
Tell us about the eyes. The eyes are just most mesmerizing.
What I really find interesting is those long eyelashes, and they're just beautiful, but they do serve a purpose, and they do help keep sand and things out of their eyes. They also have a secondary eyelid.
The additional eyelid also helps to keep sand out of their eyes. Their furry ears and slit-like noses serve the same purpose.
But you know, there's an allure about a camel. What is it?
They're very unique animals. They're different than a horse. I think they're smarter than horses. They're very affectionate. They recognize their names and come when they're called, just like a dog. I tell everybody these guys are my overgrown chihuahuas.
So they're big puppies, right?
Big puppies. Now, if you remember 40-40-40, you can remember three important facts about camels. They do live to be 40 to 50 years old. They can drink 40 gallons of water in one sitting, and they can run 40 miles per hour. Now, it's not pretty. We're going to go that way. It's not pretty. It's not graceful. It usually involves food.
After our camel trek, it's time to load up on the bus and time to see some of the other animals on the ranch.
Those are cypress domes. They're dormant in the wintertime, and they're actually a filter for the water out here.
It was only a few moments after entering the preserve that we were greeted by our first animals.
Here they come.
I know, they're rotten.
JJ had warned us about these eager animals with a reputation for following the tours in search of a handout or two. Llamas are native to South America and are cousins to the camels. Measuring up to 6 feet tall, it was easy for these guys to grab treats right out of our hands. Llamas are social animals, living in herds, and they're intelligent too. They can learn simple tasks rather quickly. Used as pack animals, llamas can carry up to 130 pounds for short distances. But llamas are also known to be fiercely protective and are sometimes used as guard animals.
Llamas are known to be protective. Out west, they take gelded male llamas. They put them in with their sheep and goat herds right before the babies are born. Then any babies that are born are their babies, and they'll protect them from danger.
As we were busy feeding the llamas, we were joined by a bird of different feathers.
Here comes one of our ostriches. That's a female ostrich. And I know that because of her coloration. Females have this gray color. The males are black. And that works out for them because the males sit on the eggs at night. The females sit on the eggs in the daytime.
Ostriches are the world's largest birds, standing between 7 and 9 feet tall and weigh around 240 pounds. Oh, and did we mention? They don't fly. They can run, though. Sprinting at speeds up to 43 miles an hour, those long, powerful legs can cover 10 to 16 feet in a single stride. And don't underestimate the might of their kick. It can be deadly. Those legs also give us some insight into their past.
They're really cool looking. They look prehistoric. They're the closest living relatives to the T-Rex.
However, unlike the extinct predator, ostriches are omnivores, feasting mostly on plants, roots, and seeds. Ostriches live in pretty small herds, usually only about 6 birds total.
Now, ostriches have some really cool stuff. You know, when she lays eggs, she can lay an egg about every 3 days.
A normal-sized clutch is 10 eggs, so it would take 30 days to lay those eggs.
The eggs don't start to gestate until the last egg is laid. They start to sit on them. That way they all hatch at the same time.
After becoming good friends with the ostrich and llama, we're escorted on to our next destination, which is guaranteed to be something we have never seen stateside in the wild. Still ahead on Animal Outtakes.
Once he's had breakfast, it's usually nap time.
Our safari adventure continues with a snoozing warthog and some rather large bovines. But first...
So the kudus and the elan, where are they originally from?
Africa.
We'll meet some aloof antelopes. That's next.
For thousands of years, we've been humans' best friend. You've been through a lot, and we've been right there with you. A dog is part of the family, a confidant, and a friend who always knows how to get into your heart. So what happens to our beloved companions when we can no longer care for them? This is why we've created Dante's Den, an innovative, state-of-the-art facility that will provide care for up to 100 dogs.
Dante's Den is a community for joyful dogs.
Millions of Americans face uncertainty when planning for the future of beloved pets who may well outlive them. Dante's Den is a charitable organization, so in whatever capacity you can, please lend your support so that we may continue this most wonderful work.
Dante and I would like to thank you for watching and for also opening up your hearts to our wonderful community of joyful dogs.
Learn about the many ways you can become involved by visiting dantesden.org.
Hi, I'm Marcia Panucci, founder of the Dante's Den Foundation.
And I'm Ron Dixon, the executive director out at the Dens. Dante's Den has come a long way since its inception to where we are now.
We've helped hundreds of dogs since we've opened, but now we need your help.
We sure do, Marcia. Dante's Den needs great volunteers to help us feed, walk, and play with all of our furry friends.
So come on out and enjoy our 50 acres of beautiful countryside where you can also feed miniature Holstein cows.
And their babies.
And Hee-Haw.
The donkey.
And Buttercup.
A beautiful miniature horse.
If you would like to be a part of our joyful community of dogs, please visit dantesden.org.
Or call us toll-free at 844-DANTE'S-DEN. That's 844-366-8336.
Come on out today and see what makes us so special.
For me, it started with one hit of sardines. Oh, sardines. That's where I learned to beg. It was easy to score free fish. I mean, hey, with this dolphin smile... Yeah, it's illegal, but no one cares. I had a monkey on my back, but I was jonesing for people food, hanging out under boats, dodging props and hooks, and doing dangerous stuff, I'm ashamed to admit. Look, I know that I can kick this if people would just stop feeding me.
Today we're on a safari. Well, not exactly. We are in Central Florida, getting up close with some exotic animals, though. After feeding some ostrich and llama, we've cruised into our next paddock, which features some interesting antelope species.
We have three species in here. We have the eland, and the kudu back here, and then we have Mr. Oddad over there. Isn't he beautiful?
JJ points out the greater kudu, which is found in eastern and southern Africa. They are one of the tallest and longest horned antelopes in the world. Their spiral horns are a giveaway, but you can also identify these animals by the distinctive stripes and spots on their body. But those horns are rather impressive. The male's horns are longer than the female's, growing to be about 6 feet long, and twisting 2.5 times.
And one of the things they do with these horns is one of the Jewish ceremonial horns, the shofar, mm-hmm. is made out of kudu horn. They're hollow, like all horns are, so the people store things in them. One of the things they store them is honey, because it looks really cool when it dribbles out. Last but not least, they're from Africa. In Africa, you're going to have medicine men. Medicine men want a set of those because they can capture and store spirits, both good and evil.
Sharing this same pasture is another type of antelope, the eland.
Ah, there goes that baby. There's that baby eland. Just was running there. Those are the one to the far right by the trees is the male. The ones to the left are the female. Both the males and the females have horns. The female horns are straight because they'll use them for protection. That male has a twist in his horns, and he uses them for fighting. He's huge. He's almost a ton. He's almost 2,000 pounds, almost all muscle. Look at him. Is he not gorgeous?
And we saw the babies just briefly, but they're protective of them.
Yes, they are protective of them. Now, a lot of your antelope and your deer have a tendency to hide their babies. These forest antelope we see tend to keep their babies with them. So it's a little bit of a different parenting option. But these guys are very protective of their babies. And if they feel that anything is different or they're not sure of what's going on, they're going to take the babies down into the trees because that's where they blend in.
So, JJ, as the animals get further away, they have... It looks like camouflage. Can you tell us about the stripes that are...
Yeah, these guys are both what are called forest antelope, and to blend into the trees, they have thin white striping down their sides and a little bit of white under their eyes. It kind of mimics the sunlight coming down through the trees. They'll also have hair on what's called a dewlap underneath their necks and sometimes across their shoulders and down their, like a mane down their necks. And if you look at the way the grass grows, they're at the edge of the cypress dome there. You can see how that would all help them to blend in so that they wouldn't be able to be seen. You want to know how they get through the trees? When they get in, the trees are too tight, they tip their heads up, and it runs their horns down their sides of their neck, and then they can weave through.
Because the eland and kudu share similar habitats and diets, they live well together on the ranch.
What we have out here is a mixed group, but they're all forest antelopes, so they get along quite well. Almost everything out here eats basically the same diet. We have antelope and deer and things. We keep hay out here, and they have the grass, of course. They also get grain every day. And then we have, in each pasture, we have a little area that has what we call a lick in it. And it's a mineral lick so that they can go and lick and pick up any extra minerals that they need that maybe they're not getting in their food. Much like you'd have a salt lick for a horse. Yeah, I can't believe they all went in the trees. Rats.
As the antelopes slowly disappear into the cypress dome, we head off to our next pasture, where there are some amazing animals waiting to greet us. Up next on Animal Outtakes, our walk on the wild side continues.
But look at the horns, look at the eyes.
As we come face to face with some pretty impressive cattle.
Hi, I'm Marcia Panucci, founder of the Dante's Den Foundation.
And I'm Ron Dixon, the executive director out at the Dens. Dante's Den has come a long way since its inception to where we are now.
We've helped hundreds of dogs since we've opened, but now we need your help.
We sure do, Marcia. Dante's Den needs great volunteers to help us feed, walk, and play with all of our furry friends.
So come on out and enjoy our 50 acres of beautiful countryside where you can also feed miniature Holstein cows.
And their babies.
And Hee-Haw.
The donkey.
And Buttercup.
A beautiful miniature horse.
If you would like to be a part of our joyful community of dogs, please visit dantesden.org.
Or call us toll-free at 844-DANTES-DEN. That's 844-366-8336.
Come on out today and see what makes us so special.
Monday on ABC 7 News at 7.
We're just not actively making phone calls on the presidential campaign yet, but I expect that to happen fairly soon.
Florida's Trump campaign on standby. Find out why local reps are waiting until after the convention to reach out to voters on the Sun Coast. I'm Haley Wilgus. We'll have that story plus our roundtable discussion.
Monday on ABC 7 News at 7, your Sun Coast news. We're here for you.
We're losing exotic animals on a daily basis, and the ones that we have in captivity are really the ambassadors for their wild counterparts. I'm Clayton Rozier from the Big Cat Habitat and Gulf Coast Sanctuary, housing over 150 exotic animals that needed a great home. And if you love animals, please help them. Do it locally. Support your local no-kill shelters, your local wild animal sanctuaries. Make a difference where you can.
Hurricane season is here, and so is the official Sun Coast Hurricane Guide from ABC 7. This essential resource arms you with vital information you need to protect your family and property when severe weather threatens the Sun Coast, including how to create your readiness plan and survival kit, shelter locations, what to do with pets, and important phone numbers. Visit MySunCoast.com and download the official Sun Coast Hurricane Guide from ABC 7. Brought to you by the Florida Lottery.
Well, diabetes is an elevation of blood sugar. So the pancreas is an organ of digestion that has little sort of islands, we call them actually islets, inside of it that have cells producing insulin. The insulin makes sure that all that glucose we eat, all that sugar we eat or process, gets put into our tissues so we can flex, we can move, we can be active, because we feed on that sugar, and particularly our brain. So when you have diabetes, what happens is you have a lack of insulin, and you can end up having a lot of blood sugar in your blood, but it's not going to the tissues. So you have a patient with high blood sugar, or we call it glucose, that is actually unable to really move as well, is getting weak, and they can get prone to infection, they can get prone to a lot of secondary diseases. So what you need to know is that regularly you need to check your pet for blood sugar once a year, get a full blood work, just like you and I, and also be aware that there are certain breeds that are more prone to it. Cats can often get diabetes. Certain breeds of dogs can have it. So ask your vet, is my dog a breed prone to diabetes? If your dog starts drinking a lot or peeing a lot, that's a very, very big sign that maybe diabetes on the list. Could also be urinary tract infection, could be another endocrine problem, but that's definitely one of the big ones. When you have a lot of drinking and a lot of peeing, possibly urinary tract infection, skin infection, ask your vet.
As our antelope encounter drew to a close, our safari adventure was still just getting started. Our next stop included some of nature's more visually interesting creatures, the zebra.
All of the stripes on a zebra, are they all the same? Because when you look at them from the side, they look uniform.
Yeah, zebra stripes have a couple different uses. One is for camouflage. If you're being chased by a lion or a hyena and you run in a large group, it's hard to tell where one zebra starts and the next one ends. Also, most of the things that hunt these guys hunt early in the morning and late in the evening, so it gives them an indistinct outline, make them a little harder to pick out. But they do some things that people don't think about. And one of the things is that no two zebras have the same stripe pattern. So it's like a fingerprint, like you have a fingerprint. The other thing that's cool about zebra stripes is they never get flies. Flies have eight faceted eyes. They see everything eight times. It's like a kaleidoscope. They look at that. That is a nightmare gone wrong. Yeah, don't want to land on it. Don't want to bite it. You just don't want anything to do with it. So I'm thinking if I ever get a chance to go on a picnic, I might take me a zebra stripe tablecloth along.
You know, the zebra tails look like they're braided, but they're not. It's actually their markings,
is it not? Yep. Aren't they cool? They're one of my favorite. And you know, the further south you go in Africa, the wider apart the stripes get.
Zebras live in small family groups, but those groups will sometimes combine to create herds of thousands. There's protection in numbers, and while these creatures look tame, they are fierce.
What is their temperament? I've always heard that they're a little mean.
They can be vicious. They will stomp on and kill almost anything lower than their bellies, and they've been known to kick lions and things in the jaw and break them.
After taking in the sight of these beautiful zebras, it was time to move along.
They're wildebeest, and they're famous for a couple things, and they follow the rains in Africa, and they travel in numbers so large they can be seen from outer space. It's called the Great Migration, and it is so cool.
From the bearded wildebeest to another face only a mother could love, the warthog.
Once he's had breakfast, it's usually nap time.
Related to our domestic pigs, these sturdy hogs have protective bumps or warts on their head, along with four sharp tusks. They feast mostly on grasses and plants and will use their snouts to dig up roots or bulbs. Not far from the warthog's home, we find a family of lemurs spending the afternoon relaxing on their own private island.
This is a troop of ring-tailed lemurs. They're the most common ones. Now, lemurs come from Madagascar. It's the only place you can find lemurs. There are over 100 different species of lemurs. They are what are called prosimians. It means before monkeys. They have a common ancestors with monkeys. But while monkeys have in Africa developed the prehensile tails and all that stuff, these little lemurs, they reach this point, you stop. So they're basically a prehistoric monkey.
And just beyond the lemurs, we find some impressive cattle.
These are Watusi or Anacola cattle. What they're called depends on who owns them and where you find them. They use them as currency in Africa. Doesn't matter how much gold you have, it matters how many of these you have. In fact, if you have a daughter, you want to have a bunch of them, it's how you'd pay her dowry. The horns look really heavy, but they're not as heavy as they look because they're hollow like all horns are.
While not the longest tip to tip, the Watusi do hold the record for the largest circumference at the base of those massive horns.
Because they use them for currency over there, they don't eat the meat, but they do use the milk. So they're basically a dairy cattle.
As our safari wound to a close, we were reunited with our llama friends, and met some new animals who were eager for some attention.
But look at the horns, look at the eyes.
These are the water buffalo, the largest bovine in the world.
Well, I have fed my fair share of cows, and they are as gentle as can be, and so are these guys.
Found in Asia, the water buffalo measure 8 to 9 feet from nose to rump, and you can add 2 more feet if you include the tail. And don't let them step on your toes. These massive animals can weigh over 2,600 pounds. After finishing up their snack, it's time to head back to the base. During our safari, we learned a lot about the exotic animals on the ranch and marveled at how well they all cohabitate together.
I hope that when the people come out here and see these animals, that they'll appreciate them and they'll go away with the idea that they want to protect them. They want to make sure that their kids and their grandkids and their great-grandkids are going to get to see these animals. And if we don't start taking care of them, that's not going to happen.
Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Monday at 4 on Suncoast View. We've got everything you need for your 4th of July festivities. I'm Stephanie Roberts on a special Suncoast View. We brought in the Sarasota County Fire Department to help us with our fireworks and our grill. Our beauty expert keeps us cool and comfortable with summer skin solutions, plus her must-haves to beat the holiday heat. We talked to MC Hammer about his new rap venture, plus a field trip to Popcraft Popsicles. Monday at 4 on Suncoast View.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to save a life? Find out by donating platelets at Suncoast Blood Bank.
I'm Haley Wilgus, ABC 7. Platelets aid in the clotting process and are vital in the treatment of cancer and surgical patients, trauma victims, and critically ill newborns. It's tough to keep enough on the shelves because they only last 5 days. To donate, call this number or visit scbb.org, and you can help save a life.
ABC 7 congratulates Suncoast Blood Bank on 65 years of serving our community.
Thanks to my volunteer, I am a better reader.
Thanks to my volunteer, math seems simple now.
Thanks to my volunteer, I discovered new career goals.
I'm a volunteer for Sarasota County Schools, so I know I can make a difference. And you can too. Give an hour, change a life.
On Animal Outtakes, every week, it's a new animal adventure.
From meeting curious lemurs to feeding big cats and hosing down rhinos, there's never a dull moment. And sometimes these amazing animals chime in. Tune in to Animal Outtakes to find out what they have to say.
Watch Animal Outtakes this weekend on ABC 7.
Animal Outtakes is produced by Dante's Den Foundation, a nonprofit group dedicated to creating the best life for dogs. If you would like to learn more about Dante's Den, donate, or volunteer, visit our website, dantesden.org.
Well, Marcia, our wildlife safari has come to an end.
But we hope you have enjoyed learning about all of these amazing animals. Join us again next week for another outstanding animal adventure.
We'll see you soon.
Let me see if we're getting closer.
Yeah, I wouldn't go much closer than
okay.
That. You know you're getting away with this because there's a camera, right?
You know you're spoiled. There's one down there, but you don't want it. Here you go.
Look at your legs down for right now.
Wildlife. Yeah.
Try again.
Whatever it was.
Hurricane season is here, and Suncoast weather can go from this to this in seconds. So when severe weather threatens, count on the official Suncoast Storm Team at ABC 7.
We're armed with the most advanced weather technology so that we can bring you storm warnings faster and with more detail than ever before.
Plus, we focus on the Suncoast and track storms right down to your neighborhood.
On air, online, and on your mobile device, turn to the official Suncoast Storm Team at ABC 7. We're here for you.
Don't miss the 32nd annual Sarasota Powerboat Grand Prix Festival, June 25th through July 4th. This year's festival features a kickoff party at the Sarasota Yacht Club, boats on main block party, 2 days of aquacross and powerboat racing off Lido Beach, bayfront fireworks, and so much more. Produced by and benefiting Suncoast Charities for Children. For festival info and VIP race day viewing tickets, visit SarasotaPowerboatGrandPrix.org.
Hurricane season is here. Are you prepared? ABC7 has the information you need. Access our special Surviving a Hurricane now. Learn how to prepare a readiness plan and survival kit. Know your evacuation route. Be prepared, Suncoast, when severe weather threatens. Access our special on our ABC7 app and all our live streaming platforms.
Apple TV, Amazon Fire TV, ABC7's Pump Patrol, a list of the Suncoast's cheapest gas on mysuncoast.com. ABC7, your Suncoast News. We're here for you. Weeknight.